Welcome to the talk, Resolution with Symmetry Rule Applied to Linear Equations. This is a joint work with my supervisor Pascal Schweitzer. First, I want to give you an overview of our results and their background. Then I will dive deeper into the main ideas of our work. Resolution is a proof system for propositional logic, and it's a classical tool in automated theorem proving. It works on formulas in conjunctive normal form, and it uses just one deduction rule. Here is an example of how a resolution refutation looks like. We are given these clauses in the top row, and we form a tree-like deduction using our resolution rule. At the end, we arrive at the empty clause. This means that this set of clauses is unsatisfiable. The main motivation for our work came from graph isomorphism. A graph isomorphism is a bijection between two graphs that preserves the edge relation. We have a decision problem GI where we ask whether such a graph isomorphism exists between a pair of graphs. This problem is not known to be in P, and it's also not known to be NP complete, so it's a candidate for NP intermediate. Also, it's closely related to finding symmetry in structures. We take the approach to encode graph isomorphism in propositional logic and then apply resolution. Resolution has some problems, mainly its high proof complexity. That means the proof length may grow exponentially with the number of input clauses. A classic example for this is the pigeonhole principle. It says that when we map n plus 1 pigeons into n holes, then some hole has to have two pigeons. Showing this using resolution requires proofs of exponential size. Another example is graph isomorphism, or rather showing that two graphs are not isomorphic, and this result is due to Thoran. So then the idea is to enhance resolution using the so-called symmetry rule. If we derived a clause C from a formula F, and F has a symmetry sigma, we may derive sigma of C in one step. Here's an example. We have a formula F, and we derived the clause X using resolution. We observe that swapping X and Y in this formula is a symmetry, because doing so simply swaps the first with the third clause and the second with the fourth. So we can apply the symmetry rule to immediately derive y from x. Note that we could also have derived y using resolution. Thoran's resolution lower bound used CFI graphs. CFI graphs are made from these sketches here on the right, and they also provide lower bounds for some graph isomorphism algorithms. They are, however, quite symmetric, so we have the idea to use the symmetry rule to obtain shorter non-isomorphism proofs on these graph classes. Another interesting graph class are the multipede graphs. They provide exponential lower bounds for individualization refinement graph isomorphism algorithms. These algorithms are used in practice in tools like Naughty, Traces, and so on. They are also based on the CFI gadgets. However, they can be asymmetric. So the question is, can the symmetry rule still be applied here? A key fact is the relation between multipede graphs and linear equation systems. The automorphism group of a multipede graph is actually the solution set of an equation system. Here I give you an example. So we took the approach of using the symmetry rule on linear equations and showed that the same process can also be used on multipede graphs. Here are our main results. If we are given an unsolvable equation system over the finite field Fp, then we can construct a resolution refutation using the symmetry rule, which proves this fact, and its length is bounded by a polynomial in the number of equations. From this, we infer that also non-isomorphism of multipede graphs has linear-sized resolution refutations using the local symmetry rule. Additionally, we show that the CFI graphs have linear-sized resolution refutations using the global symmetry rule. Now I will talk about the main ideas in more detail. There are different variants of the symmetry rule. We consider mainly the possibility to swap a variable with its negation. This is called a complementation symmetry. Also, there are different domains on which the symmetries can live. If we can only use symmetries on the whole input formula, we have the global symmetry rule. If we can use symmetries on subsets of the input formula, then we have the local symmetry rule. There's also a dynamic symmetry rule, which we don't consider. Exponential lower bounds for the global and local symmetry rule are known, but we show upper bounds for specific applications. A key idea is encoding problems into propositional logic. This can also be done for graph isomorphism. Basically, we introduce variables which represent the mapping of vertices. Then we generate clauses which ensure that this mapping is a bijection, and also we make sure that this mapping preserves the edge relation. Together, this means that this formula is satisfiable if and only if the graphs are isomorphic. Previously, I talked about the relation between multipede graphs and linear equations. This actually comes from the CFI gadget. It is known that the symmetries of the CFI gadget are exactly those where we swap an even number of AB pairs. If we encode these swaps as variables, then an even number means that the sum of these variables is equal to 0 modulo 2. And this is exactly a linear equation over the field F2. And then graphs made from these gadgets induce sets of linear equations. So how do we get from linear equations to resolution? We can encode linear equations also as CNF formulas. And if an equation system is inconsistent, so has no solution, we can get a contradiction 0 is equal to 1. Using linear combinations. We can simulate these linear combinations in our CNF encoding using resolution. The problem here is that when we combine equations, more variables can occur in a single equation. And the CNF encoding of equations requires an exponential number of clauses. So this way we can't get short resolution proofs. Here's an example of this process. We have three equations, and when we add them together, all the coefficients cancel out. So we are left with the equation 0 is equal to 1. On the right, you see the CNF encoding of these equations, and we can take the clauses and do a resolution proof, which leads us to the empty clause. So we proved using resolution that this equation system does not have a solution. Now I will show you how to achieve short resolution proofs. We use the symmetries found in linear equations. We observed that negating an even number of variables is always a symmetry. In this example, we negate x and y, and thus we simply swap the first and the second clause and the third and the fourth clause. So it's a symmetry. Then our approach is using this symmetry by deriving only a single generator clause when combining equations. Then we can use the symmetry rule to derive remaining clauses on demand immediately from this generator. A generator for this example would simply be the first clause, and you can check that by negating an even number of variables, you can get any clause from this generator. However, we still need to check that the symmetry rule really allows us to apply these symmetries. Here's an example. We want to combine these two equations, and the variable x2 cancels out, so the sum equation consists only of x1 and x3. So we want to be able to use the symmetry phi, where we negate x1 and x3. But phi is not a symmetry for the equations 1 and 2. When we apply phi to the clauses of the first equation, we get a new clause, which shouldn't exist. The solution for this problem is to extend our symmetry. We also say that we negate x2. This simply doesn't make a difference for the sum equation, but now we have a symmetry for all equations, so we can use the symmetry rule. Another example, here we want to add three equations together. And here we want to use this symmetry of the sum equation, but it's not a symmetry for equations 2 and 3. And we also can't fix this problem by extending the symmetry. However, we observe that every clause of sigma has a subclause in one of its summands. That means that stronger clauses already exist, and that means that we don't actually need to derive the clauses of sigma. And we are already done. In our paper, we show that these examples generalize and one of the two cases always holds. So let's summarize the approach. We combine equations by deriving sum clauses using resolution. And then always one of two cases holds. Either we can derive a single generator clause and use the symmetry rule, or otherwise we already have subclauses and we don't need to do anything. Doing this inductively yields a short resolution refutation. We generalize this approach from F2 to FP, where P is a prime. Then the CNF encoding of equations gets harder, and we also need multiple generator clauses. The subclause property does not always hold here. So we have to use a divide and conquer approach with some overlap. But we show that we can get resolution proofs of lengths bounded polynomially in the number of equations. And this is our main result. There are still some interesting open questions. Firstly, are there short proofs for general graph non-isomorphism using the symmetry rule? If that were true, it would imply that graph isomorphism is in co-NP. Also, how powerful is the dynamic symmetry rule? No lower bound is known and no equivalent proof system is known. I hope you enjoyed my little talk and thank you for watching.